This is More Than Mental with Greg Willits. He's not a doctor, but he knows what's in your head. For those seeking joy in the midst of a broken brain, and for those who love them, here's your host, Greg Willits.
Sitting under the sun lamp once again, taking in all those, whatever it is, it's probably giving me cancer for all I know. I really have no idea. It makes me happy, though, so I use it. I actually got some plants lately. How about that? I mean, it's like some extra oxygen in my office. Some happy pheromones going around. As we continue to talk about how you and I and those who love us can have a little bit more joy in this world, even in the midst of dealing with mental health issues. They hit all of us at some point. It's, again, if studies are showing that more than 50% of the nation is dealing with it in some way, what are we doing to be able to help ourselves to live happier lives? And it is more than just a mental thing, right? I keep saying this on all the previous shows, that you can't just focus on the mental health issues. You can't just focus in on what can I do in terms of deep breathing today, or did I take my medicines, or I have to go to my therapist. All these things are great. For many people, all these things are necessary. All these things are things that we must be doing to maintain that balance in our lives, to make sure that we are doing things to be healthy. But one of the things that I have known about for a long time, and I have actually implemented in my life, is you got to exercise as well. And I hate this. I'll be honest, I'm not a fan of exercise. It's one of those things that we all know that we have to do. And there are times in my life where I have really gone deep in exercise. I remember when my second son, who's now going on 20 years old, when my wife was pregnant with him, a buddy of mine that I worked with gave me a pointer and told me to go buy a copy of a book called Body for Life. Remember Bill Phillips? He had like EAS supplements and all of these different things. I mean, I took Myoplex out the wazoo. I think I had Myoplex coming out of my nose. And then I lived for my free day. He was a big proponent. You eat super disciplined, 6 meals a day. You work out 6 days a week. And one day a week, you had this free day. I literally would go to bed the night before my free day with an unopened can of Pringles sitting next to my bed so that I could wake up on my free day and start eating. That's how pathetic I was. I went through Body for Life, got in fantastic shape. I went through P90X a couple times. I ran a marathon in 07. My knee is still angry at me about that. But these are things, I go into these fits and spurts of exercise. And even just a few years ago, I was blessed to be living in Colorado for a few years. And you can't be in Colorado without eventually getting a desire to get in shape. I mean, people are walking everywhere, and I almost think it is a required uniform that you must wear yoga pants when you go to the grocery store. And when I got to Colorado, you wouldn't want to see me in yoga pants. And quite honestly, even when I did get in shape, you wouldn't want to see me in yoga pants. But the point is I lost over 60 pounds when I was out there just walking and watching what I ate and felt so much better. And I remember even recording videos and talking about it on shows of just the stress level going down, that I wasn't even as concerned about my weight as I was my stress level going down. And even though I know these things, it's still so incredibly difficult to maintain this mindset of, I know I need to exercise, and then actually doing it, actually putting on the shoes and going for the walk, putting on the workout shorts and getting in the gym. It's hard to keep that mindset going. So now that my wife and I have relocated back to the great state, our home state of Georgia, and now that we're here and we've been settled for a few months, one of the things that's been high on our to-do list is to get ourselves back in a gym, because both of us, throughout the course of moves and stressfulness and illness and all these things that we've dealt with over the course of the last few years, saw an increase in weight, and our stress levels were affected because we weren't exercising and the things that exercise does to our brain. So as I have gotten myself back in a gym, one of the things that was really incredibly difficult for both my wife and I to do was pony up the extra cash to pay for personal training as well. But we knew that we've gotten a little bit older. My wife is older than me by a whole 6 months, but it doesn't matter. She's a much older woman. That we knew that we needed help to be able to do what was good for us, right? And again, as we're talking about More Than Mental, we know that focusing on our spirituality is good for us. We know that focusing on our body is good for us, our mind, the work that we do, our hobbies, all these things, it's good for us. And so I've only been back in the gym for a few weeks. I'm living in a perpetual state of soreness. And despite the fact that I'm constantly aching, and when I get up out of bed in the morning, somehow my butt hurts. Not that part of my butt, but my butt cheeks from just doing whatever squats or thrusts or whatever my personal trainer is making me do, I still said, you know what? I need to have this guy who is maintaining a positive attitude and helping other people get in shape and get in shape mentally as well. I had to have my own personal trainer on the program. So joining me for More Than Mental, Elliott Rodriguez. Elliott, thanks for being here, man.
No problem. I thought this was a trap the whole time. I knew you've been sore. So I was like, okay, this guy's inviting me over. There's going to be a trap. I'm going to walk through the door. I'm going to get the pie to the face. There's going to be a trash can.
I woke up and I'm just like, okay, this is a weird sensation. It's just like just trying to roll over. Every part of my gluteus maximus was just screaming at me. It's like, yeah, see, this is not something that you need to work out on. But apparently, you know, what do they say? You want to build up your biggest muscles, and if build up your biggest muscles, you burn more fat. Well, apparently my butt is my biggest muscle, because that's the part that seems to be getting worked out the most.
100%. I mean, I'm in the same boat. I told you I was sore walking in, and like I was trying to go to bed last night, and I was doing overhead presses, and I'm trying to go heavier, so I'm loading up the bar on my back, and I'm going overhead, and I'm sleeping last night. I tried to lay down, couldn't get right, and I just started doing this like 360 motion in my bed of just turning over and turning over. And eventually my girlfriend got up. She's like, either A, you got to sleep on the couch, or you got to figure out how to get comfortable, because I can't deal with this any longer. And it's like 2:30 in the morning. I'm like, I am so sorry, sweetheart.
I keep a foam roller under the bed. There are times where I will get out of bed. If I'm that sore, I'll get out of bed and I'll do a foam roller on the floor, just because I'm like, I'm just, my legs are jumping all over the place. I got to tell you, the other day, Jennifer and I went to the gym, and it wasn't one of our days to work out with you, but we went up and we were just going to try to get in half an hour of cardio. And so we got on the treadmill or the ellipticals and trying to hustle. I mean, I felt like I was getting a pretty good sweat up, but I don't know if you noticed that I was listening to you training someone else. And I almost said something to the person that you were training. I know.
Well, no, I'm just kidding.
You brought her right next to me and you put her on a stair machine. And this young woman, she was obviously overweight and she had some weight to take off.
Yeah.
And when I go to the gym and I see someone who's overweight, I tend not to think, oh man, look at that fat person. I tend to think, man, what courage that person has to be showing up and doing what they're doing, and good on you. And I'm on the elliptical and you had her get on this stair climber thing, which I am still intimidated by. I haven't gotten on the stair climber, but you put her on this thing. And you're standing next to her, and the thing that impressed me so much, and I was going to say something to you previously, and I decided, you know what, I'm going to hold off, and I'm going to just kind of put you on the spot here on the show, was how patient and kind and encouraging you were, because I heard her saying so many things that I've heard me say to myself. I can't do this. It's tough. It's really hard. I'm so weak. And it's not that she's trying to get out of it. But even as she is proving to herself that she's capable of doing something, she's telling herself that she can't. And I heard you encouraging her. And it's like, listen, if you do 5 minutes, you've done 5 minutes, and that's great. But how often do you hear people telling themselves they can't do something in the midst of actually doing it?
And everything that people talking to themselves and telling themselves that they can't do something, that's not just in fitness, that's in life.
Yeah.
And that's specifically to the gym. I hear that every day. People come in, tell me they can't do something. And let's just use a chest press, for example. You just sit down on a machine, do the chest press, start knocking it out. They're like, man, I've never done over 90 pounds or what, you know, give me a number. It could be whatever amount. Right. And they told her, so they can't do it. They've never been able to do it. They can't do it. It's this barrier that they have set upon themselves. It's all self-imposed. You know what I mean? Nothing in this life really, like, I can tell you can't do something, and that you can either A, allow that to put a barrier up in your head and you're like, Elliot's right, I can't do this.
Yeah.
Or you can figure out a way like, no, I can do it. And the people in the gym that can't do that chest press, I'll do a set. I'll have a conversation with them, have eye contact. All of a sudden with a sleight of hand, I drop a pin and they do a press. I'm like, hey, look at what you just did.
Yeah.
And you did it while having a conversation with me.
Yeah.
Not only could you do it, you haven't been pushing yourself hard enough. You thought you've been doing the right things, but the things that you thought were right have led you to this point where you're still holding yourself up with your own limitations.
Yeah.
So you think you're doing good, but at the same time, you're telling yourself, hey, I can't do this. I don't know if I can do this, or I don't know how to do this. Or speaking personally, last week, my dad was in the hospital, and I was I'm blown away by this, so I have to bring it up. He's talking to a neurologist about what exactly happened? Because my dad is fully functional. I'm super blessed. He's able to walk, talk, everything. You wouldn't, if you sat across from him, you wouldn't think he's a man who had a stroke. So the neurologist trying to talk to him, and he seems like a genius. You could just tell he, this guy is like uber smart. And my dad said, yeah, I watched a YouTube video. I think I'm all caught up. And like was dead serious about it. He was not trying to tell a joke. He thought by watching a few YouTube videos that because he couldn't sleep at the night, so he was a little nervous. So he watched, I guess, all the videos on people dealing with the stroke.
How long ago did he have the stroke?
Last Thursday.
No kidding.
Yeah. This past Thursday.
He's all caught up. He's watched YouTube. He's all caught up.
Yeah. Last Thursday to now.
Yeah. Wait a minute. I think I'm having a stroke right now. Never mind. I'm all caught up.
Yeah, okay. Right. I was like, hold on. Let's watch a YouTube video real quick. And I sat there and I'm like, you know, I talked to my dad after the discharge and I was like, you know, you said that. And I didn't want to say anything because I was, my blood pressure, and even talking about it now, my blood pressure is still going back up thinking about it with how like angry I was. And then I took a step back and I realized, I was like, my dad thinks that for a certain reason. I still don't know why he thinks that. So I went to ask him. And he's as stubborn as I am. But to get back to the point of all things, that he lived this lifestyle where he used to be super in shape. He used to play for the University of Florida. Mm. So super...
Playing football.
Yeah. Super strong man. Very in shape. You know, had me, quote unquote, and that's why he got out of sports and football and whatever and whatever. And he got out of shape and now he has type 2 diabetes and it's all not self-imposed, but it's like, you know, they kind of go hand in hand. He had a bad lifestyle, unhealthy. He got type 2 diabetes and hasn't really dealt with it, but has been doing things. He's like, yeah, I know how to do this. Yeah, I know how to do this. And he keeps bringing that. Yes, I know how. It's not just like I can't, but I hear the, yes, I know how to, and they really don't. Mm. And what you have to, I guess instead of just me coming here and venting about that, the best thing that if you're listening to someone and you're like this and you think you know everything and people are around you are trying to give you some suggestions and you're not completely open to it, my biggest takeaway would be take a step back, realize that even if you tried something for a month, right, and it doesn't work out, in the grand scheme of things, you haven't really wasted that much time and you've learned something. This is all about a mindset. I'm gonna keep going back to this mindset, and this is the healthy mindset that I want everybody to try to pick up. And I speak a lot on sports. Winners win, or they learn. Mm. Winners don't lose. And I'm not saying everyone has to be a first place winner in life, but the mentality of like not losing and learning, that a loss can be positive. You could take a positive out of a bad situation, no matter how bad it is. I mean, there's some times where you think, oh man, there's no good situation to this. Well, maybe there's not a direct thing to say like, oh, this is the good lining out of it.
Right.
You could say, hey, this is the, you know, like how I handle the situation, how I handled it is the positive lining. This could have crippled people. I mean, I'm looking at your board and it has Superman on it and Man of Steel on Logan. We look up to these guys, not because they fly around at capes, for what they represent.
Yeah.
They've dealt with a situation that most people can't deal with and they rise to the occasion. I think that a rise to the occasion is what most people find motivating, and everyone can rise to the occasion because at the end of the day, it's all showing up.
You know, I think a lot about, you hear about entrepreneurs say, fail early and often. You know, I've in the last couple of years developed a bit of a dislike of the word failure. I wish that there was a better way of saying it. It when your outcome isn't what you expected it to be, that is your opportunity to learn.
Yeah.
And it's also an opportunity to restart. It's an opportunity to hit reset. And just like I was saying at the beginning of the show, I did Body for Life. Well, guess what? I fell off the wagon. I could say, all right, I screwed up and this is the way I am now.
Yeah.
Or then another thing came around and I said, I have to keep pushing. And here I am. I've been on this quest for 20 years of getting in good shape. And it's a constant push. And that's one of the things I think that so often people convince themselves that when they can't do something, that's when the downward spiral happens. I'm not a believer in you can do anything if you just put your mind to it. So, for example, I'm not going to be president of the United States any day soon. Yeah. I won't be Pope. You know, I could tell myself I can be, but there realistically, what are the things that I can do? I can get in shape. I've proven that to myself in the past.
Yeah.
I can reach goals. I can accomplish certain things. And hitting those goals, sometimes just small goals. I mean, so for example, forget about saying, I want to lose 100 pounds.
Yeah.
Can you get to the gym 3 times this week?
That's a smaller achievable goal. And then if you focus on those smaller goals, that can help you hit your long-term goal. And so whether you think about mental health issues, right? You think about your family. What is one or two things that you could do this week to strengthen your relationship with a loved one? What are one or two things that you can do this week to reset in yourself a positive mindset about yourself, you know, especially if you are negative about yourself. If you suffer from depression, if you suffer from anxiety, you may tell yourself, you know, I hate myself, I dislike myself, I can't do this or that. What are one or two things? And same thing with exercise and mindset. What are one or two things I can do this week to prove to myself that I'm capable of doing something? Now, how did you get into fitness in the first place? I mean, what was your backstory that led you to become a fitness coach?
Yeah. So we have to go way, way back, and I'm only 25, so way back is like a decade.
So what you're talking about is we got to go right before I got married, is what you're saying.
Yeah, right around that time frame. I was always like a thick kid. Don't get me wrong. Like I played baseball growing up, and I was definitely the dinger. I played outfield. I wasn't going to do much of anything. They just had me up to hit balls because that's what I was really good at. So I was always thick.
Can I start calling you that? The dinger?
Yeah.
What's up, dinger?
What's up, dinger? Yeah. If I don't answer, you know why. But I wanted to play football like my dad. I love my dad. He was my best friend growing up. He was my biggest motivator. He and I are still really good friends, even though he and I butt heads all the time. I love him to death. But I want to play football, right? Mm. So my freshman year, I get the opportunity to play varsity football, and I actually, my like second game ever, I run a route. I just run up in, catch ball. Someone's helmet goes right into my knee. Mm. Yep, I have a fake meniscus in my right knee, and I actually wound up doing some tearing to my ACL on my left. And a little while after, I had an ACL repair. And the recovery time, looking back at it,
this was in high school.
Yeah. This is my freshman year in high school. So this is 2009. Looking back at it, I was kind of a wimp. I got injured. I didn't want to push my knee.
Yeah.
You know, like I was like, oh man, I have two bad knees. I can't do anything. I got bad knees. I started feeling bad for myself. And I was a football player. I needed to eat big to get big. So I started eating. I did the IC food diet. I saw it. I ate it.
Mm.
It was on your plate. Nope, not your plate no more. It was mine. like I was just consuming everything. And maybe in part because one, I had the mentality of like, I wanted to get big like my dad. Oh, so I just ate. And then the other part of it was like, I was a little depressed. You know what I mean? Yeah. And it got to a point in time where I looked in the mirror and it was like, okay, it's 6 months after my recovery and this is, or my surgery, and this is when I'm supposed to be recovered. And I'm way worse than when I even had my surgery. I think I was in better shape right after my surgery than about 6 months after, just because I ate so much weight and I just sat on a couch and I got really good at Halo. Mm. I could destroy anybody in Halo. I guarantee you in that sand. And I just got sick and tired of being sick and tired. I woke up and I had excuses. I would point my finger, and I forgot where I heard this analogy from, but it's like if you point your finger at something, you got three more fingers pointed back at you.
Mm.
And I just started like really, really being self-conscious, and not of myself physically. I was already self-conscious of myself physically. I had a bigger chest than any girl in my high school. I mean, it was bad. I needed a sports bra. So I was already self-conscious of myself, but I became self-aware of how I was talking to myself, the committee within my head. And I started noticing that when things got hard, I started looking for an easy way out.
Mm.
And I just, I needed to stop that, right? I look down, I can't see my toes, let alone my own manhood. It's not right.
Yeah.
So I decided to just start moving. And I said, okay, I want to be able to run the distance of my neighborhood, which was like from the gas station to my house was a mile. I wanted to be able to run down there and like walk back. And I think I got about 20 steps and I was out of breath.
Wow.
So, but I didn't let that stop me. I just started walking. And I the next day I ran and I did it again. And I did it again. And I just started running until that mile became easy. And then I pushed myself. And at that point in time, my family wasn't the most financially set.
Mm.
So for me getting into the gym and speeding the story up a little bit, I went to Anytime Fitness in Alpharetta. I've worked with Anytime Fitness since 2011.
Oh.
And I went up to the owner and said, and this is not the Anytime that we're part of now.
So this is 2 years later. So what was your fitness level at this point? Were you still overweight?
Yeah, I was still, so this is about 2 years after my surgery, maybe 2010. I'll say 2010 because about a year afterwards.
Yeah. And were you going there for a job or just to sign up to start exercising?
Simply for exercise.
Oh, okay. I got you.
So, but I didn't have money.
Like, I got you.
And at that point in time, my parents were divorced. Mm. It was not a very good situation. So I went up to Davin, the owner, and said, you know, hey, can I, you know, clean the bathrooms and mow the lawn? Like, kind of as a joke, but serious. Like, hey, yeah. I'll do grunt work. And I literally mowed the lawn, did the weed whacking, all, like anything that was for Hispanic labor with my last name Rodriguez. He went to Liberty with it. And I, you know what? And I love him for it because it got me a gym membership. He became a second father figure to me when I didn't have my dad for a little while in my life.
What I love about that is, again, you know, I got four boys and a daughter, and just the thinking outside the box of there's always a way. There's always a way to reach something. And the fact that you had that mindset of going up, that you didn't have the cash. I'm going to get in there somehow. Yeah. You didn't let that stop you. That's awesome.
Yeah. And I think that once more, it's all about a mental space of like, okay, I want to do something. I know I'm deep down. I think most people know what they're capable of.
Yeah.
Right. Like we all have, I'm working to be the best Elliott that I can be in 10 years. And then when I'm Elliott at 35, I want to be the best Elliott at 45. So I want to be working towards that. Thank you, Matthew McConaughey, for that quote. But I guess I was fortunate enough to listen to that at a point in time in my life when I was still trying to figure out who I was. And I saw these guys in the movies and I was like, I want to be like that. So I started working to be like that. And it never come across phony or anything because I genuinely wanted to be that person. But as a kid, I don't want to say I was so coddled, but I was so soft and so weak mentally, all of it. If things got hard, I might go to my parents, anything. So I got sick and tired of wanting to rely on other people. I wanted to learn how to rely on myself. And then that, I've taken that energy and propelled that into basically everything. And where I'm at now. So I get to the gym, I started, you know, mowing, doing the bathrooms. And then there's a guy, his name was LaVon, and there was a dude named Josh. Josh was the manager. LaVon was the trainer. LaVon, huge, huge dude. Jack, dreads out the wazoo. I pestered the heck out of him until I could work out with him.
Yeah.
And I never got training. I would just say, hey, can I work out with you? Hey, can I work? Because he was the biggest dude in the gym. Yeah, I was like, yeah, I'm the biggest dude in the gym, but you're the most jacked dude in the gym. So I want to be the opposite of what I am. And eventually started training me, and I would pester Josh, who wound up later going to the Marines, about like, hey, I'm here. I don't want to go home. Because at that point in time, I was with mom, stepdad, and I didn't get along. So I was like, hey, look, I'm just going to be at the gym all day. So I learned how to do the basic managerial stuff. And then once Josh left for the Marines, instead of me, you know, like mowing and doing the bathroom, I got upgraded.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, I started doing the front desk work, and then LaVon left. And then I was like, okay, well, you know, do I want to do this or do I want to train people? And I had a few people like friends and, you know, whatnot who I would train, but it wasn't like actual training.
But just getting that experience, I mean, that's just fantastic at such an early age too.
Yeah, and it was just it was all organic, and I was super fortunate to be a part of Davin's crew when he was growing. So it wasn't just a club in Alpharetta; then it became Milton. Mm. So then I learned what it is to expand a club and how to open a club and what it is to staff that club and what it is to get machines and all of a sudden have the machines don't have the stuff that you ordered, and it became much more than coaching. It became that entrepreneurial side where I was just super driven. And I was like, this is what I want to do. I found when I was in elementary school, I drew a comic book, made up, like would print up of it. And I would sell it during lunch for 25 cents. I've always had this thing. And growing up, I wanted to, be a comic book illustrator. I was in graphic design. Even though I did sports and I wanted to be like my dad in sports, I did art. I was performing arts. I did all of it. I wanted to be an entertainer of some sign, of some sort. Just because I like talking to people.
Yeah.
You know, I've never not liked talking to people. I've always been afraid to be the center of a spotlight, and I don't like being the center of attention as it is. That's not my personality. I want everybody to win and everyone to succeed.
Well, let me ask you this.
Yeah.
So one of the things that I find really interesting is when I'm very introverted, believe it or not, and a lot of people are always really surprised because I can host shows and I, you know, do public speaking. I do a lot of, but I spend a lot of time, you know, here we are, we're recording in my office, right? I spend a lot of time sitting in my office working by myself. You deal with so many people that are coming in And you were probably getting a lot of people at their weakest points.
Yeah.
That they are coming in. You probably don't get a lot of people coming in saying, you know what? I'm so super jacked. I want to be even more jacked. I'm going to go join this new club. If they're already jacked, they're probably have gotten themselves there at some point.
For sure.
And when they sign up, they probably don't need much help. The people that are coming in and need a physical trainer to help them keep going probably are walking into the gym with a level of baggage that they're carrying, and not just the physical weight baggage, but the emotional baggage as well. What are some of the biggest concerns that people have when they are showing up? What are some of the mental roadblocks that people are bringing into their own lives that are keeping them from trying to get physically healthy as well?
There's so many different things that people bring in. Yeah. I mean, you could talk about having poor relationships. There's been so many. I've had the craziest things of people coming in saying they've been depressed and that they want to lose weight and they're at a worse spot because a loved one shot them. Physically shot them. And then I've had people come in and just say that they want to lose 20 pounds because that's what they wore in high school. But both of those situations are drastically different in the level of like how traumatic they were in their life. Like physically, someone got shot, someone fit in a dress in high school, but both of them put the same amount of mental carriage on them. So you have to figure, like for me, my biggest thing is I want to get to know somebody. And it doesn't happen overnight. Like it takes a little while. And I wouldn't want to be able to sit down with somebody and find out like what is the mental baggage that you're holding out with. Very hard. Most time when someone comes into the gym, I say, hey, you know, you signed up the gym. What are you here for? I want to lose 5 pounds. I want to lose 10 pounds. I want to feel strong. I want to flatten out my stomach. Stuff like that. And I don't want to say it's generic because I don't want to seem arrogant or rude when I say that, but it's almost like I asked that question and I know it's going to happen. And for me, it's like an onion. Okay. That's the base level. Now, why do you want to lose 5 pounds? And the answers from there could be so different depending on if it's a male or a female or it's young, old, you know, whoever's sitting across from me. Let's just go online. It's a woman who wants to lose 5 pounds for her husband. Why do you want to lose 5 pounds? Well, I want to look good for him. Why do you want to look good for him? You know, I want to make him feel good. Okay. Well, you know, what would 5 pounds do for yourself?
Yeah.
Like cool. We get you, you know, you want to satisfy a husband or vice versa. You want a man for his wife. I want to lose 5 pounds because I want my wife to look at me the way she looks at, you know, a bowl of spaghetti. maybe more than 5 pounds, maybe 10 pounds, but I want that affection. Okay, cool. You got that affection. What would that do to you? Like after you receive that love and that affection, how would you feel? And then when I get a chance to really ask that, because it takes some conversation. You have to be comfortable enough with somebody to say, hey, you got that affection. How would that make you feel? Most people don't, especially guys, don't want to talk about how they feel. That's not macho. You know, The Rock doesn't talk about how he feels. He's, you know, charismatic, does whatever he wants, but he never talks about how he feels. And maybe that's true, maybe that's not. But I'm just saying for the man, full testosterone way, talking about your feelings isn't manly.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying that it's manly, it's macho, but you have to become self-aware. You have to understand how you feel and why you feel that way. If you feel upset because you didn't go to the gym or that you cheated on a meal or something along those lines, it's okay to be upset. Don't get mad at yourself for being upset and then allowing that to be this vicious circle that keeps you in negative. Just own it. Yes, you ate some freaking ice cream.
Yeah.
Who cares? Last time I checked, I ate a tub of ice cream not too long ago. I'm not sitting across the table overweight. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I don't like hearing the excuse. My best friend gave me the excuse that I work in a gym. It's an easy scapegoat for me. Sure, I do work in a gym. Yes, I can walk outside my office. There's a pair of dumbbells. I can literally just start doing curls. It's great. But at one point in time, I wasn't. I worked as a CNA at an assisted living facility. And that was a normal job. And I still had my same level of workouts. It's just because I made it a priority. Once you make something a priority in your life, you're going to find a way to do it.
I love the idea of having the reasons why and how you dig into that more deeply with people of saying, okay, there's probably some other core thing other than just I'm overweight and I don't feel good about the weight right now. For me, it's really kind of interesting. All those times I worked out, I had this goal of just wanting to be in better shape. And I would, I used to, you know, like I remember this is again, 20 years ago. I remember before Photoshop was a thing, using a graphics program and superimposing my head over another face that I found in a bodybuilding magazine and put that up where I was lifting weights. And I was trying to mentally tell myself that's what I wanted, but I couldn't tell you why.
Yeah.
I couldn't get to the why of why I was doing that. And so I think that's part of why I would slip out of working out for a while. And now that I'm older, one of the things, and now that I, when I have had success, like when I lost a whole mess of weight a few years ago, just by walking, of I want just my brain chemicals to be flowing properly. And exercise allows that. Exercise helps facilitate that.
Yeah.
And it's weird because that's so far different than the reason I used to, which was I just want to look good. You know, I think about Kevin Spacey. I know a lot of people don't like hearing about him anymore, but Kevin Spacey in American Beauty, he goes to these neighbors of his that were always out walking, and he asked them for advice on what he should do to start exercising. They said, well, what is your goal? And he said, I just want to look good naked. That was his goal. I just want to look good naked. And that's fine if that's what your goal is. But for me, that's not enough anymore. I don't care what I look like naked.
Yeah.
It's a matter of, is the gunk in my brain flowing or is it stuck in my brain? And working out, you know, a year ago when I was working, lifting on a regular basis, I remember I would go to the gym and I would almost go in there trying to work the stress out of me by lifting the weights as hard as I possibly could.
Yeah.
What's interesting is that I actually had a doctor tell me, because it was also in the midst of, I didn't know that I was in the midst of PTSD when that was happening, when I was lifting like that. And he told me that, ironically, and I don't want any listeners to use this as an excuse not to work out, but he told me that level of stress that I was at without being properly supervised medically, that I was actually introducing a new level of stress into my body, because when you lift weights, you're causing stress.
Yeah.
And so I was inducing even more stress in a stressful situation, which may have helped the PTSD get as worse as it did.
Yeah. Help trigger it.
Yeah. And so, or just give it strength, you know, but then he said, however, don't let that be an excuse not to do it now, because now that I've been in recovery for as long as I have been, and I am getting the supplementation that I need, and my you know, basically the chemicals in my brain are firing more easily. Now the best thing, he said, the best thing, more than the medicine that I could be doing, is getting myself in the gym and exercising, because it's going to be, you know, it's studies show this, that it increases happiness, it increases productivity. If you increase productivity, you're gonna have greater happiness, you're gonna have more peace in your life, all these other things. So let's talk about how, you know, someone listening right now that is maybe in the midst of some sort of depressive episode, or even someone, and this is one of the aspects that I like to talk about on the program, is for people who are caring for people who are dealing with mental health issues. They too are dealing with stress. Exercise could help them as well. What's a starting point? So I want to talk to the people who aren't exercising at all right now. What's a simple starting point? And I mean, people all around the world listening to this, they may have access to a gym where they're at, or they may live in the middle of nowhere where there's not a gym. What's a way to get started? And maybe what are some simple goals in the first week or two that they can try to hit so that they're feeling like they're being successful? And at the same time, it's going to be doing something, even though they're working out their bodies, it's going to be doing something positive for their brains.
I would say the first thing that I would recommend anybody do is actually grab like a notebook and start writing down your thoughts, because that writing down your thoughts forces you to think about what you're writing down, and it forces that inner dialogue, forces you to understand and hear that inner dialogue in your head. And when you write something down, you might write something down, and I'm not going to say crazy, but something crazy, like
something unexpected,
and you go back later in a few, you know, a future time, you go back and look at the past and you were like, I can't believe I wrote that, you know, what was my mental space? And then you start thinking about it, and then that's how you become self-aware. So that's what I would say, start writing everything down.
I love that.
Yeah. The second thing would be, okay, be 100% honest with yourself. And if you have the receipts, go look at your receipts of what you've been eating, because I promise you, you are what you eat. No one got fat off eating all the broccoli in the world. You know what I mean? And really just be honest with yourself. Most people know how to eat healthy. Most people understand eating pasta 3 times a day, not the right idea. You know, switching out something like cereal for yogurt in the morning, it's a great fix. Yogurt, good healthy fats, good protein, not high in carbohydrates. Most people consume so many carbohydrates, so cutting out one meal with carbohydrates, that's an easy way to cut out some carbs and replacing it with some healthy fats, some probiotic, some protein. If yogurt's not your thing, that's fine. Do an omelet. Just think of some super simple ways to eliminate, and I'm not saying carbohydrates are the devil. I'm not saying they're bad. I love carbohydrates. Everyone should have carbohydrates. But I think on a American diet, they're oversaturated. Yeah. It's too much of everything. So really, figure out what you're eating. And once more, track everything down. There's free apps. I use MyFitnessPal. I don't track everything, but I would like to say about 80% of the time, and that's just being honest. I want to be transparent. 80% of the time, I'm tracking my food, and it's just to get an average. Now, and I would say 80% of the time is acceptable. For someone like you or myself, that's fine. I'm not trying to step on stage and look better naked. You're not, you know, and that's going to
80%. Certainly not on stage.
Yeah, not on stage. You know what I mean? If I'm on stage, there's going to be some clothes on. Unless there's some dollar bills being thrown, then we could talk. But that would be the idea. I'm just taking it, just doing one step at a time. Write it down. Just kind of figure out where you're at and just be honest with yourself. And then the realistic goal is, I can't tell you what a realistic goal is. You can only tell, what I mean by that is, if let's say you have a really cruddy diet, I could tell you a realistic goal is to eliminate one meal with carbohydrates, replace it with some good healthy protein, some good healthy fats, get on some good supplementation. That still might be too much for you.
Yeah.
Because writing it down is so much as it is. So try writing stuff down. Just try it. And even if you're somebody who's in really good shape or thinks they're in really good shape, try writing stuff down. You might be surprised at yourself on some of the things that you write down. And I mean everything. Write down what you're doing for exercise. And exercise doesn't have to be in the gym.
What would be a good starting exercise for someone who's not doing anything right
literally
now?
Literally walking.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Literally start walking.
How long? 20 minutes? 30 minutes?
As long as you can. Yeah. But when I ran for that first little bit, I took 20 steps. I was out of breath, but I still went. And granted, it took me about 20 minutes. Yeah. Really, Mark Bell, I'm a huge subscriber of Mark Bell. If you do a 10-minute walk in the morning and a 10-minute walk at night, even if you're already in good shape and doing everything, that is super good for you. Just because you're increasing your heart rate for just a little bit, and you're getting a nice low intensity steady state, some cardio, you're burning extra calories, your mind juices are flowing, you're able to think. I guarantee if you wake up and did a 10-minute walk, by the end of that 10-minute walk, you have a much better idea of what your day is going to look like. Instead of waking up, putting on clothes, getting in the car, showing up to work, and then trying to figure out what your day is going to look like while you're already at work. Mm. You should already kind of have an idea of what your day is going to look like as soon as you wake up.
I'm going to try that. I like that because I enjoy walking, but the a lot of times I have this mindset of well, if I'm going to go walking, I have to go walk for several miles.
Yeah, no way.
10 minutes, I can go do that easily.
Oh, yeah, super easy. Also, another fun fact, and this might be, I'm going to throw this out there first. I think this might be bro science, but I really like how I feel. Mm. So I'm just going with how I feel. Sorry if I offended anybody with that. if I eat food out, I really like taking a 10-minute walk. I will set a timer. My girlfriend sometimes gets mad at me because we're in a hurry. But I like the idea of eating something and walking afterwards because it does two things. One, this is once more a feeling. I can't say this works. It's like walking off the food belly. If you've eaten so much food, you're sweating. The best thing you could do is either nap or walk it off. And I really don't know why that is, but I really feel like walking off helps, after you eat a meal, helps digest that meal. I don't know why. I just feel like it does. And then secondly, it also forces me, because I know I'm going to walk, it forces me not to eat a lot of food because I don't want to waddle when I walk.
And the other thing that I like is that, 10-minute walk, you're not going to be coming back dripping with sweat, except, here in Georgia in the middle of July or something like that. Yeah. But unless, if you go for a walk, a lot of times I'm thinking, well, if I'm going to go for a long walk, then I have to time in a shower and blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
10-minute walk, you're not going to be dripping sweat. You don't have to worry about hopping in the shower afterwards. So you can do that a couple times a day.
Okay. So we're just going to keep going on these little fun, little things. I also find if you're going to do these 10-minute intervals, I like 10 minutes. I like 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes. If you're working out for an hour, I think you have to be a very advanced person. Mm. Because if you work out an hour the way that you and I work out, you're like LeBron James. You're on a whole nother level because the intensity's there, right? Mm. So when we go to the gym, we're sweating. So it's a little different. But for the idea of walking and doing something super simple, in fitness, the only way to get extra out of it is to add more. How do you want to get, you want to build a better chest? Add more push-ups, add more dips, add more, whatever it is in fitness. You want a bigger squat? Squat more. So in the beginning, I recommend for everybody, do as little as you can to get them, use the, whatever you're starting with, get the most out of it. Mm. If you're, just be honest with yourself, if you're super out of shape, if you have a hard time, you know, running, you know, steady for 10 minutes, if that really is hard for you, that is perfectly okay. Just be aware that, okay, I'm going to give my absolute best for 10 minutes. And no matter what the outcome is, you have to own that outcome and say, okay, the next time I do this, I'm going to be 1% better. And doing, like, truly, instead of going to the gym and doing one-hour period and doing 30 minutes in the morning, and then if you have the luxury to set up your life to do a little bit in the morning and a little bit in the afternoon, so much better for you.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, and think about it. If you go to the gym and you do one-hour session a day, let's break this down super simple.
Yeah.
Your heart rate's only going up really high and then really down. It, granted, it's for over a prolonged period of time, but yeah, it's only once throughout the day.
Yeah.
You cut that in half, your heart rate's still going up. You could probably do a little bit more in 30 minutes because you only know you're going to do 30 minutes. So subconsciously, you're trying to get a little
that
bit more.
That makes so much sense.
You know what I mean?
So much sense.
So now your heart rate's up. Now you rested, let's say, 8 hours. You worked out at eight in the morning,
yeah,
or 10 in the morning. You go back to the gym at 6. You do another 30-minute workout. Now your heart rate's jacked just as the same as it was this morning, but now it's done it twice today.
Great advice.
You know what I mean?
Well, you can check out Elliott's website. You can find him on Facebook, facebook.com/Elrod. That's E-L-L-R-O-D 21. If you want to see some of his fitness techniques and workouts and things that he adds on Facebook, facebook.com/ELLROD21. And you can follow him on Instagram at Elrod, ELLROD1. I will put those links, of course, in the show notes for this episode. Elliott, thanks for being here, man. Appreciate it.
No, I appreciate you, my man.
All right, next time, there will be more good stuff talking about your spirituality, your relationships, your work. As always, I love it if you would leave a review for me over at iTunes. Just look for More Than Mental there, as well as send me feedback. You can record on your phone, send it to me at feedback@gregandjennifer.com. And if you like what you hear, why don't you become a Patreon co-producer? Go over to patreon.com/GregandJennifer. Until next time, God bless.